Hello viewers and welcome to the channel. This is the Barnsdale Tunnel on the Hull and Barnsley Railway. We've come down today to film it and document it, and we're going to take you inside. So let's go. Ben's got a massive torch with him today. What torch is that?
It is an Olight X9R.
This tunnel was almost ring fenced by a heritage company to be used in the future for a railway, but that all fell apart due to mainly money. But there used to be a CCTV camera in there and extra like security on here, but I think the highways agency removed all that when they did a bit of a refurbishment in here recently to use it as storage. And it looks like someone's cut a hole in the fence there and in the gate to put a chain around it and padlock it. So someone keeps coming down here trying to lock this up when it's probably not even theirs. So that's a bit annoying. This has all been cut out with a grinder and someone's put a massive alloy padlock on it. That isn't a railway type padlock and that's been cut. The gate's been cut. So that's how we got in today. It's wide open. 1,226 yards of tunnelly goodness. We're going in from the west side, going east. And the next station stop that way is Kirksmeeton. We've previously filmed this tunnel, but I just wanted to do it again because I'm here with Ben today to show Ben, because he likes tunnels, a bit like me, and a bit like Arnold off Charlie Chalk. We all like tunnels. So here we are. We've got our first refuge there. The refuges seem wider here than they were this morning because we were filming the Weedley and Sugarloaf tunnels this morning, and it was then that we discovered that the east portal, correction, west portal of the Drewton's tunnel has been completely filled in and has been deliberately renovated. It's like totally covered over, isn't it? Gone. Cannot be seen anymore. So the east portal of the, no, west portal of the Drewton's tunnel is no more, unfortunately, viewers. We can see that refuge there has got a lot of like old coal dust and things all compacted in, pressed into that corner. And the back of the refuge is almost arched away from the tunnel as if it's all been stepped in. Very, very good architecture there, and there's a lot of soot deposits here that can still be seen to this very day. The last trains ran in this tunnel in about 1965. There was a single track line towards the end of the railway's days. The passenger services were long gone, but Wrangbrook Junction back that way was still busy with colliery lines, and there was a single track running up to this tunnel for some time before complete closure in the late 60s. Is that bright, Ben?
Just a bit.
Not as bright as that though. No. There's a demonstration with your big torch then, Ben. Let's see what it's like. This is the X9R from Olight. Wow. It just lights it all up as if it's daytime. That's amazing. That is truly amazing. Yeah. You can save your battery now, Ben, if you want to. You're getting a shot.
Yeah.
Yeah. That is the Olight X9R lighting up the tunnel for us today, giving us the f-stop that we deserve. So, moving on, viewers. Wow, see how dark it is when you turn that off? That's crazy. Yeah, so we've got the ballast bed below us. It's been scraped out and smoothed by the highways agency when they did some work in here. A couple of years ago now, that was. Oh, it's you. Thinking I can hear footsteps. It's Ben stomping about. I thought there was someone else in here. That is the ghost guy off Monsters Inc. So an adult presumably has come down here with a rattle can and spray painted that on the wall of a historic structure. Interesting. So onwards we go. See a large twig. Someone's brought that down here next to a classic can of Carlin from Burton-on-Trent. Various markings on the wall, the reflective number 6, presumably from a survey at some point in the past. Moving on, we've got a large area of soot above us here in this tunnel. This was always mainly used by steam trains because the passenger services were indeed diesel towards the end on the Hull and Barnsley Railway, but most passenger services at this end towards Barnsdale area had ceased in the 1920s due to what they say was low passenger numbers, but what they really meant was NER had taken over this railway and they wanted to throttle it back and get rid of it. It was always the intention of the NER to get rid of the Hull and Barnsley Railway because they simply didn't want it, because they didn't design it and build it. Somebody else did. They seized control of it in 1923, I believe it was, and the first act that they did was get rid of all of the original Hull and Barnsley management team. Got rid of all of them, and then they started changing it to what they wanted to do with it, which included cancelling and closing all of the passenger services at the Barnsley end. So back to the Barnsdale Tunnel. We are now looking towards Barnsdale Bar and the A1. There used to be the Great North Road at the end of this railway tunnel, but it was just a single track road back then, and the bridge that went above the railway was demolished when the A1 was widened to dual carriageway. I believe that was in the 1970s, but if anybody can correct me on that, please do leave a comment and let me know when the A1 was widened to a dual carriageway. We can see here some silicon that's been pushed into the joints here in the tunnel wall. This was done by, I believe this was done by enthusiasts in the early 2000s. We've got a large soot deposit there on the wall, very large, and then there's salt deposits that have grown on the soot. That's quite interesting to look at, actually. I've not actually noticed the different colours there in the past. It's almost like the salt deposits have grown on top of the soot, giving a dark base and a lighter top. So interesting. That must be an inch thick of soot and salt deposit as we move away from the silicon repair on the wall there. Look at an almost immaculately clean 11 numbered refuge. Moving on now. Got all these survey markings. I don't think these were in here when I filmed this a couple of years ago now with Dave. L63, L64, L65. They look about, well, it's not in meters. Not quite sure what distance that is. It'll be about 1, 2, 3 meters apart, I would think these numberings are. This was also something done by the enthusiasts, I believe. It was to let the water out, and somebody has smashed a hole through the back of each refuge to let excess water through. Don't know if that's actually helped or if they've just wasted the time. I don't know. But if the hydraulic pressure of the water above wanted to get through, it would let us know. Looking here, viewers, we've got a 200 marker there. So I would imagine that's 200 yards from that portal there. And that is the west portal. 200 yards from there. So we look at the quite recent ballast bed that was added when this tunnel was refurbished for motorway maintenance vehicles storage a few years ago. Those vehicles are now in use on the A1, as the A1 is going through a roadworks and repair thing between Darrington and Barnsdale Bar. The works are ongoing. Ben taking some photographs there. Check him out, that is King of Winter. We've got another bashed through refuge there, and we can see the natural material through there that's completely dry. So I would say that that was done in vain. Not quite sure what type of material that is. It looks like a granite-y stone. Any materials experts out there, please let me know what type of material that is. Quite misty in here today. It's rained quite heavily the last couple of days, viewers. I was going to take Ben to a different tunnel, but that tunnel will likely be flooded, so we didn't even waste our time driving up there, because it's a couple of hours away from base camp. Passing the reflective number 15 there. Got some other people inside, and a dog, I believe. Hi there! So, continue on. We've got some barbed wire in the middle there, Ben. Don't trip over on that. A lot of soot deposits as we pass the number 16. Wow, look at that. When Ben turns his torch on, it just lights the full wall up. I'm not going to turn around and look at it though, because it's like a headlight on a car. That's mad. How the soot deposits are just clinging to the wall after all these years. They're still stuck there from the last steam trains. As we come up to the first tunnel vent, these are capped off. I read recently that the capping above is literally... Oh, I had some wire stuck to my foot then. Sorry about that, viewers. I was just steadily tripping over. I think it's wire from a tyre that's been burned. That's an old rubber tyre, I believe, and that's the radial belting. From within, as we are going to position ourselves to look up this tunnel portal. Tunnel portal, tunnel vent. There it is. Look, it looks like there's railway line going across, then corrugated sheeting, but there is a hole in the top there. I've never been over the top to try and find these, but I should do one day. Yeah, gimbal's been a dick, unfortunately. Sorry for the language, viewers, I just found it very frustrating. Yeah, one tunnel vent there. In almost immaculate condition, quite moist, but other than that, in good nick. As we look down now towards the rest of the tunnel, we've got two more tunnel vents to look at, viewers, so keep watching as we continue this explore. We've got lots of material here which is likely part of the top of the tunnel vent that's been knocked off and pushed down, because a lot of the time it's kind of in the way of what the farmer's trying to do above, such as farming and tractoring and things. So moving on past number 19, got myself thinking about tractoring now. I've been watching Jeremy Clarkson's farming program. That's quite good. If you've got Amazon Prime and you haven't watched it, check that out. Not sponsored, just seems relevant since I mentioned tractors. Soaking in the photons here, viewers, as we look up at some thick soot deposits up on the tunnel roof there. The sort of granite-y sootiness reflecting back at me as we look through the deep mist now in this tunnel. The floor's really nice though. Thank you to whatever agency's done this, because when I came down here last time it was a right mess. Really undulating, smashed glass and all sorts. And it's all been scraped out and re-leveled with a massive amount of this lovely gravel that's quite nice to walk on. And see where the air pressure, the natural air pressure in the tunnel has been greater here, and it's held the soot in place as we move away from that first tunnel vent. And tunnels are a funny thing. There's a principle called Bernoulli's principle, and Bernoulli was a scientist in yesteryear, and he worked out air flows and air pressures and how the circumference of a tube with airflow within it could determine how that air flowed. So you see boy racers with larger exhausts where it's popping and banging, that's because there isn't enough airflow for the gas to get out, and it's almost going back on itself, and that's what creates the popping and banging. Plus they don't fit them properly and they have air leaks. Going off topic, viewers, but that's why the soot's formed there and that way, and then this area, barely any soot has stuck to this part, and then it deposits again there. It's all to do with Bernoulli's principle of airflow. And in tunnels, that's very important indeed. Ben coming towards me there. I just thought it looked good on the monitor, so I thought I'd film this piece for you, the viewer. As we look back at Wrangbrook Junction that way. And we're going to look past number 23 reflective marker and the 350 yard line at the other portal. So that would be right, we've got about 1,000 yards to do. So those markers, I think, are in yards. And that's not quite sure what that is. Well, that's Ben. How are you finding this, Ben?
Yeah, decent.
Decent.
I just can't see.
Hey? Just can't see, I'll keep blinding him. Yeah. So, I've had the litter bugs down here, Mentos, and somebody who's been using Lynx deodorant or probably snorting it, but the lungs all smell nice. So, we've got another portal there. I keep saying portal, I do talk rubbish, I do apologise, viewers. That is a refuge, and you can see the arched bottom area that was a key feature on the Brierley and the Barnsdale Tunnel. The Druton's Sugarloaf and Weedley Tunnel didn't seem to feature this part, but I was telling Ben off camera before we came in here that the Brierley and Bairdale Tunnel, even though the part of the Hull and Barnsley Railway, were built by a different team of navvies to a slightly different design. As we look there at some deposits on the wall there, can't remember what they're called.
Calcite.
Yeah, Vicky was telling me about this, why bricks go white, but I can't remember what she said, because I've slept since then and I ate a 12 inch Subway lunch that Ben got me. So, reflective marker number 24, as we pass the 50M, don't know what that means. We should be coming up to another tunnel vent soon, viewers, so keep on watching. Don't know if you've seen the Hull and Barnsley Railway series that I did a few years ago, but if you check that out on the ALW Research Team YouTube page, those videos will be there. We did the entire 66 mile railway back in about 2021, myself and Exploring Dave. It also featured Paul and Harry in parts. So Harry's in Paris this weekend, having fun with trains and tall things that he likes. Don't know what any of those markers mean. They're all new, those dots and stuff, that's all new. They weren't there a couple of years ago. You can see some calcite, as we're calling it, coming through that hole that's been bashed through the portal wall there. Pretty sure, as I mentioned, that was done by the enthusiasts a few years ago when they had a hold on this tunnel. Unfortunately, their plans never came to fruition. They also said one of the reasons was they couldn't get any coal. That was their words, not mine. Passing reflective marker 29 as we battle on through the mist towards Barnsdale Bar. We'll call this the Yeti Refuge due to the white calcite that's coming down the walls. It's almost completely filled the refuge there. We've got some like red stuff there too. That's interesting how the different materials soaking through the wall are coming out in different colours. We've got some browns, we've got some whites there. We'll get a close-up view of what's going on. They call these B-rolls from back in the day when they had different reels of tape, and they do a B-roll and an A-roll. That is the natural water soaking through the stone here at Barnsdale, making its way through the gaps in the bricks, and it's running down there and splashing in this refuge. Did you hear that, viewers? That little pop 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 noise. Which is so cool. Can see some vehicle tracks here. They're actually from a tracked vehicle that have been in here. That was probably one of the machines that is now in use on the A1. Another track there from marking from a tracked vehicle. I was saying to the viewers, Ben, that all this like gravel wasn't here when I filmed it. You know, when I did the Hull and Barnsley Railway series, this was all added the other year. It's mad how this works. This is completely dry. That is bone dry there. Whereas we can hear other areas that are absolutely sodden, where the water's just choosing its path into this tunnel. Oh, interesting. There's quite a flow here. Oh, this is another feature I've recalled now. Something else the enthusiasts were doing. They were knocking holes through the wall and putting bits of tubing. Let's see if any of them are actually working. No, they're not, because the water will go where it wants and it's just coming through the bricks there, all flowing down. That wall's completely white. You can see in there there's the remains of a wooden piece in there that's been completely engulfed by the calcite, but that is a wooden board affixed to the wall, and below it there's a proud brick standing out, and it's presumably a post to mount something to, and then it would be affixed to that as well, but I'm not sure what it would have been. As far as I know, there was no signalling in the tunnel itself. There's quite a few discarded bricks at the side there, viewers. Not quite sure what they're all about. They're more modern bricks from the 90s, I would say they're from. They were possibly brought in here to do repairs. That'll be the enthusiasts again, because they're not engineering bricks, they're just like house bricks. That would explain the difference there. And I wonder if they were trying to do repairs. Looks like they have done some here. They sort of keyed some new bricks into the existing bricks there, trying to repair it. And again, there's a lot of the silicon that was used. I'm not quite sure why they were putting silicon in the gaps of the mortar. Been quite a lot of effort put into that. There'll be somebody sat at home who in the past used to come down here on the days off doing jobs like that in here. Not quite sure why, because I don't know what benefit it would have done to that structure. We've got a Department for Transport, Hull and Barnsley Railway 3, and it's 132 SH2, so that means shaft 2. So that's a marker for a shaft, which is right there, viewers. That's the Department for Transport marker to look at this shaft. We call it a tunnel vent, but the Department for Transport have named it a shaft, so we will call it so. Quite a lot of soot there, but it looks like this ventilated well. Don't know why my gimbal's doing that. If I didn't have to fix the light to it, I'd probably just turn it off, but I need it. So there we are, that is the tunnel vent shaft number 2. I like the way the bricks are sort of prouded there to provide like an edge. This tunnel dates back to 1885, viewers. Viewers, have you seen how much water's coming through the wall there? It's just flowing in. It's flowing in that crack, running down the wall. It's constant flow. But due to the new ballast bed that's below, it's not wet underfoot at all. Look at my boots are dry. Tell you what, they weren't this morning though, when I was doing the Weedley and Sugarloaf tunnels. It was a bit moist this morning, wasn't it, Benjamin?
Just a tad.
Yeah, a little bit moist. As we move on from air shaft number 2 and continue our journey this way. Got some golden wonder transform and steak or something there. They sound disgusting, but if you like those, that's fine. Not my scene. Air's nice and fresh today. I'm particularly enjoying that. So we pass another set of bricks there, just laid up near this portal. And we can see where someone's done a repair there, and well, it's completely the wrong angle. But nice brickwork, I guess. Passing reflective number 40 in the soot there, and the 600 yard line. So we're about halfway now. So let's look at the distance there compared to there. Yeah, we're about halfway. Looks very misty at either end though. Very misty. As we pass number 40, So, got the H there on the wall, and H there. Don't know what that means. Oh, 19th of May, 99. Oh, that's interesting. H. 19th of May, 99. That's interesting.
That's the same as the shafts earlier, so date of repointing work.
Date of repointing work, yeah. We were looking at the fifth tunnel vent on the Drewton's Tunnel earlier, and that had markings like that in the centre of the screen. Can you see that, viewers? I'll try and zoom it in a bit. 19th of May 99 has been sort of scrubbed in. I've never noticed that before. I'm sure I didn't see it last time. And then, what's that one? Yeah, 19th of May 99. That looks like it's been done by a professional because the mortar's just so. Interesting. Don't know if that's what H means, but I saw it because I looked up at the arrow. You can see the profile of the tracked vehicle that's been down here. It's been left marks in the ballast bed. Got some more repairs in that refuge there. Number 43 reflective is in the refuge there. As we pass 650, we're getting closer to the Barnsdale end of the tunnel now. There used to be a feature along here. I can't remember what it was called, but keep watching because I will show you that, viewers. See, I don't know what that is up there, but it looks like a person stood near the fence. Can you see that? The soot deposits on the roof are a lot thicker now, viewers, as we're at the midpoint between two vents, or shafts, as the Department for Transport call them. Moving our way along the Barnsdale Tunnel, passing some more brickwork repairs done with domestic house bricks there. Passing reflective marker number 51. The actual structure and mechanical integrity of this tunnel is very good. There are slight signs of wear and tear, but this 1885 tunnel is in very good condition overall. 800 yard marker there, viewers. Now that, there, viewers, that is the top of one of the tunnel vents. That is what would have been on the surface, and that part there would have been the very top. And at the end of this tunnel's days, somebody has broken that off and pushed it down the tunnel vent. Can you imagine the thud that would have made when it hit the bottom? There's some more brickwork behind it, and those are the darker stones that we saw along the entire length of the Hull and Barnsley Railway at just about every engineering point, such as bridges, little culverts in the ground. As we move on past these soot deposits here above the reflective number 54, there's another part of the top of the tunnel there. As you can see, everything has been moved to the side, and that was done by the Highways Agency when they put the new gravel bed inside this tunnel. As we look up to the third tunnel vent there, or shaft as the DFT call it, you can see the way that the smoke has swirled round in the tunnel and then gone up the vent there. I can almost make it out with the soot marks, how it's swirled around as the trains have gone through, assisting the volute of the vent. As we look up that shaft to the surface, gives an impression of how deep we are. Very interesting. Quite a wide gauge shaft that, to let a lot of air flow through. As we look down here at Hull and Barnsley Railway 3132 shaft 3. So that's possibly, I don't know what the number 3 would mean, but HBR is Hull and Barnsley Railway, SH3 is shaft 3. Not quite sure what the 132 means, but if anybody does know, please do get in touch by leaving a comment, because I do like to hear from you. It is, I do enjoy reading the comments. We've got another marker there, DFT, Department for Transport, HBR3, 132, shaft 3, which I can only assume is that. Just looking past Ben there, and his torch. Can anyone remember Jamie and his magic torch, the children's TV show? I used to watch it when I was very young. I was about 4 when that came out. We only had terrestrial TV back then. I remember when Channel 5 came out on terrestrial. What is the earliest TV channel that my viewers can remember? Please leave a comment. This is the feature I wanted to tell you about. This is Sharon's Spring. So looking at that marking there, that looks like it was done by a professional bricklayer, just the way that the cement has been bonded to the wall there. And then I don't know who Sharon is, but that's Sharon's Spring. A few years ago I was down here with Dave and he actually drank from Sharon's Spring. He gave it a good lick. Not for me. Do you fancy it, Ben?
No, not at all.
Okay. Yeah, that's a no from Ben. Well, that is Sharon's Spring, viewers. Let's have a look up Sharon's Spring, viewers. See if we can see up there. Wonder how deep it goes. Looks like something stuck in there. Lots of water though. A lot of water. I wonder if that's always been there. I wonder if that was an original feature of the railway tunnel. Because it looks like it was engineered in. Doesn't look like it was added afterwards. What do you think, viewers? Please leave a comment. Let me know what your thoughts are of Sharon's Spring. As we continue past a lot of old style bricks cast aside. I wonder if they're from Peeway tunnel repairs over the years, where they've replaced bricks where the fronts have gone. They've pulled them out and just left the spare ones to the side of the track. So past reflective number 57. Now this refuge could have done with some work. It looks like the failing bricks have been pulled out, ready for new bricks to be applied, but that's never happened. For whatever reason, that work didn't go ahead. Shame, really. Maybe one day it'll be restored. We just don't know, do we? Never say never, viewers. Just listening to the sounds inside the tunnel, viewers. Just been taking some photographs, viewers, with Ben and his magic torch. So we move on. Passing that refuge. Not bad condition. It's got three little dots there. Looks like some sort of survey mark. Not quite sure what that's about. Oh, we've got another H there. So what's that looking at? What's the H looking at? What does it mean? What does it mean, viewers? There's nothing there. H horizontal? Is that what it means? Can't see anything different in the brickwork here. Just all looks the same, viewers. What do you think? What do you think the H means? Some soot deposits there. That brick there looks a bit different, but it's not like a keystone or anything. There's a letter H pointing up. Yeah, get in touch if you know what that is, or if you've got an idea of what it might be. Very dark this bit, viewers. That's brighter with Ben's big torch. So, I've been filming today with a base ISO of 800, so I'll see what the footage comes out like. Hopefully it'll be nice. But I'm still getting used to this new camera. It's got the Cine S-Log Cine L-LUT on it, which I'm used to basic cameras. I grew up with film cameras where you had to set the light, the ISO and the f-stop yourself, and it was all manual. Whereas these new digital cameras, it's like a lot of it's automatic, and I never really know what my camera's doing. So at the minute it's shutter speed 1/25 and f1.8, which I'd probably select a slower shutter speed, but Sony knows more than me, so that's what I'm using. I've got repairs there. Ben's taking a photograph. See the mist? Just breathe out, Ben. Ben's breath's more misty than mine. Don't know why that would be. Lots of soot on the roof now, because we're past the last tunnel vent. There's only three in this 1,226 yard tunnel. One of the final tunnel vents, I'm thinking about tunnel vents. Refuge there, they've had some silicon repairs there. I mean, if it works, it works, I guess. Looks a bit moist up here, viewers. You can see a lot of the faces of the bricks have popped off there. What causes that is the bricks absorb the water through the winter, and then if that water freezes due to the ice, the water expands inside the brick and smashes the brick open. It parts it internally, and it usually fractures along its horizontal length, and it makes the face come off, because that's the only surface that isn't pressed against something. So you've usually got a brick above and below in a mortar bed, and then usually something behind it in a tunnel. So it's usually the face that pops off. And it would be why you see a lot of faces of bricks on the floor like this. The face there, and then if you look up, the faces have popped off the bricks just due to the water and the cold. But it won't be happening today, viewers, because it's about 12 degrees, I think, as we pass the 1,000 yard marker there. And I can already hear the road traffic along the A1 at Barnsdale Bar. There's currently a lot of roadworks, and when we passed over the A1, so we went a different way, we didn't want to get stuck in the traffic, it was crawling. It was, you know, both lanes chock-a-block doing 10 mile an hour. There's a large repair there to the wall that looks like it's been professionally done. That's been cut in by the Department for Transport. As we near the end of the Barnsdale Tunnel, and we are now at the eastern end of the tunnel, and the next station stop along here is Kirksmeeton. Kirksmeeton's a lovely station. The man there who lives there is called Mr. Clark, a very nice chap. but the station is now a private residence. It's a home for someone, so please don't go there. But if you want to see photographs of it, check online. I've got some on my Instagram. And I did a video there as well with permission. It was an organised permission visit, and I filmed the station. There was a TV show filmed there that had David Jason starring in it. I can't remember what the TV show was called. I never watched it, but it featured the Kirksmeaton Railway station and turntable. Was it called Midsummer Night Murders or something like that? That might be wrong, but somebody in the comments might know what that TV show was called. Starring David Jason in his later TV career. It wasn't like Open All Hours or Granville or up like that. It was one of his later ones. Shot in the mid-90s, early 2000s, I think. So this is the end. This is the other end of the palisaded and shuttered up Barnsdale Tunnel. The enthusiasts added a lot of the steel sheeting to the tunnel and the extra anti-climb bits, because they didn't want people coming in here because they wanted it preserving, because they wanted to rescue it and use it in the future. But as I explained, that was difficult to do. You can see on this gate here, this has also had holes cut in it to have an extra chain put round it for some reason. That certainly isn't something the Department for Transport would do. They'd just put one of their DFT padlocks on it. Usually a 5-digit combination lock. So this is the end of the tunnel line here at Barnsdale. Thank you so much for watching this ALW research team video. Please subscribe to the channel if you haven't done already. There's loads of different content on there that I've already filmed, and new content coming in the future. So make sure you're subscribed, hit the little bell, press the like button on this video, and leave a comment to say what you want, really. As long as it's nice, don't be nasty. Bye for now.